Harper Audio presents The Living, a novel by Annie Dillard, performed by Laurence Luckinbill. Fall, 1855. The settlement called Whatcom. The sailor put down the helm, and Ada Fishburne felt the boat round up towards the forest. She stood in the bow, a supple young woman wearing a deep-brimmed sunbonnet. She carried her infant son Glee in her arms. Without a sound, the schooner slipped alongside a sort of dock that met the water from the beach. This dock represented the settlement on Bellingham Bay. Ada Fishburne had been sailing in Puget Sound and along this unbroken forest every day for almost a week. The same forest grew on the islands they passed, too. The tree trunks rose straight. She'd seen enough of this wall of forest to know that even when the sun shone full upon it, it was always dark. From behind her on deck, Ada heard her older son, Claire, singing a song. Claire was five. A right big boy for five, long in the leg bones, like his father. And life suited him very well, and he found his enjoyment. She glanced back and saw her husband, Rooney, moving their four barrels, their five crates, their four kegs, and the rolled feather bed to the rail. Young Claire climbed up on everything barefoot as fast as Rooney set it down. Rooney tied the two cows and gave the ropes to Claire to hold, and the boy sang to them, half dead as they were. Neither man nor boy glanced up to see where he was getting off, which was a mercy, one of few, for she herself scarcely minded where she was since she lost her boy Charlie on the overland road. But she hated to see Rooney downhearted when he staked his blessed being on this place. And look at it. Ada and Rooney hauled their possessions off the dock. The baby, Glee, stayed asleep, moving its lips, and missed the whole thing. The schooner sailed on north and left them there. It was the rough edge of the world, where the trees came smack down to the stones. The shore looked to Ada as if the corner of the continent had got torn off right here, sometime near yesterday, and the dark trees kept on growing like nothing happened. The ocean just filled in the tear and settled down. This was Puget Sound, and there was not a thing on it or anywhere near it that she could see but some black ducks and humpy green islands. Way out south over the water, she made out a sharp line of snow-covered mountains. From the boat, she had seen a few of such mountains poking up out of nowhere, including a big solitary white mountain that they had sailed towards all morning, that the forest now hid. It looked like its sloping base must start up just back there beyond the first couple rows of trees. God might have created such a plunging shore as this before he thought of making people. And then when he thought of making people, he mercifully softened up the land in the palms of his hands wherever he expected them to live, which did not include here. Rooney inspected the tilting dock. Ada tried to read his expression, but she never could, for his bushy red beard seemed to grow straight down out of his hat, and only the tip of his nose showed. She watched him tear off some green grass blades at the forest edge and feed them to the spotted cows. Then he disappeared partway up a steep trail near the dock, returned, and set off up the beach. Ada stayed in the silence with their pile of possessions. Deep inside the bonnet, her bow-shaped mouth was grave. Her dark brows almost met above her nose. Her eyes were round and black. She made herself look around. The beach was a narrow strip of pebbles, stones, and white old logs laid end to end in neat rows like a necklace where the beach met the forest. The clouds overhead were still. There were no waves. It was not quite raining, but everything was wet. She saw a few frail smokes and some cabins under the trees back of the dock. She missed seeing the cabins at first because they were among the roots of the trees, and she had been searching too high, thinking the trees were smaller. In all those days of sailing past the trees, she had nothing to size them by. Rooney came back beside her and said nothing. While Ada stared at the glassy water, here came an Indian man. The Indian man, in a plug hat, was paddling a dugout canoe in smooth water along shore. He had another canoe trailing behind him and no one in it. He was a smooth-bodied, almost naked man whose face had a delicate, modest expression. The plug hat sat oddly high on his head. Little Claire must have caught sight of him, for he came flying down to the shore. The man beached the log canoe. Claire marched directly into the water to try to help, and the man looked down at the boy and his wet breeches with a trace of a smile. He brought the other canoe along shore. What was in the second canoe was feathers. It was white goose feathers, just loose. Ada looked out at Rooney. His mouth behind his red beard showed nothing, but she could see that he glanced at her from under his hat brim. The man came forward and said his name was Chawitzit. They knew he must be a Lummi Indian, for the schooner man said the local people were Lummis and right friendly. He had said, in fact, that the settlement at Whatcom would have starved to death a dozen times without the Lummis. Now the Lummi man and Rooney shook hands. He indicated, speaking English in a tender voice and making gestures, that he was selling the feathers. He said that the whole canoe load of feathers was 2 cups of molasses. He barely moved his lips when he spoke. His voice lilted. Rooney told the fellow no and thanked him. He added that they could use fresh fish or meat or vegetables if he could get them. He could. Rooney thanked him again, and his high voice cracked. It was all coming home to Rooney here, Ada thought, where one powerful effort was ending and another was beginning. They tied the cows and left their outfit on the beach. Chawitzit led them up the hillside on a short trail through the woods. From behind Rooney, Ada watched Chawitzit's sure feet on the steep trail. In the past 6 months, she had engaged in a great many acts of commerce with a great many native men of many tribes, and had accustomed herself to the sight of grown men's buttocks. Claire ran on ahead, ran back, and said, "Here's a house," which she could plainly see, a log house across the creek from what she knew was Felix Rush's sawmill. The log house was low in the forest, and there were slumps and slash smoking all around it in the dirt. Chawitzit walked straight inside, and the fishburns hung back on the bare ground. Ada glimpsed a blue apron, a white woman's face. She heard the woman greet the bare-legged Chawitzit with glad sounds, and they started talking. Then the woman came out, all smiling, and caught hold of Ada, hauled her inside, and began to weep. Ada gave in to weeping, too. The baby woke up and commenced to bawl. Rooney went out to have a look at the mill. Chawitzit had taken off his hat in the house, and Ada saw that the top of his head was flattened into a wedge, so his forehead sloped back. He and the woman, who was Mrs. Laura Rush, made a stir over puny glee equally as if neither had ever encountered such a thing as a baby. That night, Ada lay on her feather bed on the Rush's floor. Rooney slept in a blanket beside her. She thought Claire was likely sleeping in the corner with the Rush's children. They had a striking black-haired little girl named Pearl and a baby boy. Felix Rush had come in for dinner at dusk. It was Felix Rush who had bought the land and obtained Chawitzit's permission to build the mill the settlement grew up around. He owned the schooner that brought them. That very night, he gave Rooney a job at his sawmill, and they seemed fairly launched. Ada reflected that at daybreak this morning she had never clapped eyes on any Laura Rush nor Felix Rush either, and tonight they were all her world. They acted decent, more than decent, and they looked almighty glad to have company, which was just as well, for they had it. Ada's mind became aware of the prayer that her heart cried out to God all day and maybe all night, too, that he would lend her strength to bear affliction and go on. She was not aware that underneath she prayed another prayer as if to a power above God, or at least to his better nature, that he was finished with the worst of it. Her boy, Charlie, was the worst of it. For she had not braced herself for life back then, a few months ago. She did not know how life could be, how it could dish you between one step and another. She had been a merry girl, and although traveling the overland road was hard most of the time, she had a head for adventure. Claire was 5 years old, and Charlie was 3, and the road was taking their big train along the Sweetwater River. Charlie fell out of the wagon, and their own wheels ran him over, one big wooden wheel after the other, and he burst inwardly and died. There was no time to stop the oxen up ahead, though she shouted out, and Rooney turned around and said, "What?" while the wheels ran straight over Charlie's middle before he could get away. He was such a well-favored boy, people used to say he would be breaking hearts someday, when what that meant was he was breaking their hearts right now, the way his green eyes sized up a person, and his mouth was so wide and dark, and his hair stood up in front. She knew she should not love a child for being so pleasing to look at. She knew it at the time. There could be a statute about thou shalt not go looking at a child every minute, and certainly there was thou shalt have no other god before me. That might have been why he got run over. But it was harsh. Charlie had never been a god to her, but just a boy. A beloved son that God of all people should know about, and know that a person's beloved son was not a god like God's was, but just an ordinary human child, which is how life goes on, if he will let it. Charlie had been riding with her in the front wagon. Claire was larking off somewhere up ahead in the train, and Rooney walked ahead with the oxen. When Charlie got too lively in the wagon, Rooney carried him, although he was 3 years old, and Rooney's curly beard tickled his neck. Some of those men in their train carried their little ones in their arms most of 2,000 miles. They were good farmers who understood about carrying live things. That morning, Charlie was riding in the wagon right beside her, and she was looking at the neat curve of his forehead, and he stood up, and over the board he went and into the rut. Their train had 800 head of people and 3,000 head of stock. It took a week just to cross it all over the Missouri River. Oxen were slow, but they were strong, and they took one step after another. Oxen proceeded at the same steady walk, boosting up a mountainside or traveling a plain. They were like locomotives that ran on grass and turned wheels. The day Rooney first bought the teams, Ada walked around the four beasts and looked into their eyes and found nothing there, just shine and brown like wet boots. When Rooney was busy, she drove the team herself. She sat on the wagon and called out, "Up, Maud!" and "Up, Bright!" and tapped them with the whip. Whether she tapped or not, when the cow column ahead moved, the teams all down the line started up and the wagons rolled, and there was no stopping them. When they buried Charlie under an arching cottonwood tree, the spade turned up big bones, and worse. For it was a good tree to be buried under, and the immigrants who came before them on the road picked it too. Rooney held his hat and bowed his head and said a few words over the hole, and they rolled on, lest they hold up the train. A few days later, Glee was born, and they were still pegging along the Sweetwater River. He was so small, Ada kept him in an empty bacon barrel, and she took no great personal interest in him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.